Yo, what's up, beautiful people of YouTube? Welcome to Dom's Media Zone. It's been a while since I posted a video, so I figured in today's video or tutorial, we're going to do a practical example of using Canon's DPP4 or Digital Photo Professional 4. So what I've done is taken a photo and just tried my best to edit it to what I think looks the best on this photo using DPP4 to show you guys, to do kind of like a recap of all the tools that we've learned before. And if you're new to this channel, I will put some links to the past tutorials in the description so you can go check those out. So if this video is for you, stay tuned and I hope you enjoy. So today I'm going to be doing a practical example using Digital Photo Professional 4. I've got a whole bunch of photos which I've taken on my walk around in London. I was testing out a new zoom lens that I bought and I figured let's take a photo from that shoot and try to improve it to the best of my abilities using Canon's DPP4. So I was thinking let's do this photo over here. It's a pretty good example. It's a landscape photo. So first thing I'm going to do is select my photo and click on Edit Image. As the image opens up, it takes us straight into the Perform Basic Image Adjustments tab. From here, I'm going to have a look at the composition, see if it's underexposed or overexposed. In my case, it looks all right. I might increase the brightness just a little bit, just slightly. We're going to change that around a little bit later on. So for now, I've done that. Now here, the white balance adjustment, it's currently on auto. What I'm going to do is I'm going to change it to click white balance, and I'm going to select this eyedropper tool over here, and I'm going to pick an area where it's something that's gray that I know for a fact was gray, like this wall over here. I'm going to click on it and this will adjust the white balance of the photo for me. Once I'm happy with my white balance, what I'm going to do is come down here to this fine tune, and I was thinking of giving this photo kind of like a almost like a magenta purpley kind of tint to it. So I'm going to take away a little bit of the green and I'm going to make it a little bit more purpley looking, just slightly. I don't want to over do that. So I want to have this nighttime feel with a little bit of brightness on the red colors, which we're going to adjust shortly. I'm going to leave the auto lighting optimizer as is, and I'm going to drop down here to the picture style. Over here, because this was a landscape image, I am actually going to change this to landscape. As you can see, it's adjusted the settings. This photo is looking very different now in a landscape setting. What I want to do now over here on this gamma adjustment graph, I'm going to take the shadows and just bring this up until it touches the histogram. You'll see if I move it too much, everything becomes kind of black. So I just want to have this line where it just meets on my histogram. The darkers become a little bit darker by doing that. Then the midtones are over here. I'm just going to leave those as are. And this one over here is the light tones. I might actually just move this slightly. Does it make any difference at all? If I move it too close, it's too bright. If I move it a bit further, it becomes a bit darker. I'm going to move this to about here, which is 70. And the shadow one somewhere here, maybe a little bit less, it doesn't clip that much. Maybe let's have it somewhere here. Now I'm going to go down to the contrast part. So on contrast, I'm going to increase the contrast by 1, which gives it a much more crispier kind of look. And my shadows, what I'll do with the shadows, increase them by 1 as well, so that we can see a bit more detail in this photo. My highlights, which is the background, the moon over here, I'm just going to drop the highlights by 1, make the sky a little bit darker to give it a more of a nighttime feel. The color tone I'm going to leave as is. And my color saturation, I might bring that up by 1 just to give it a bit more of this punchy color tone. Now down here in my sharpness, I think I've got this set up as my default already. I've got the sharpness at 5, fineness at 2, and my threshold at 4. So if you didn't watch the sharpness tutorial, go back to my videos. There is a sharpness tutorial. I will put a link to that in the description. But basically, if you adjust the sharpness too much and you adjust the fineness too much, you can introduce a lot of noise into your photo where this threshold will counteract that noise. So I might even bring that up to 5 just to counteract the strength of the sharpness. Now we're done in the basic image adjustment tab. I'm going to go over here and adjust image detail. So in this adjust image detail tab, I'm going to go ahead and click on this little reposition the cursor button, and I want to point it at something that's actually got some detail in it. Maybe this little thing on top of the Tower of London. So right now, as you can see, there is a bit of noise in this photo. if we're really zoomed in. Luckily enough, this photo was taken with quite a good camera. It was the 90D and it's got a 32.5 megapixel sensor, so it's quite good to zoom in. You can zoom in quite a bit without losing detail, but nevertheless, I'm going to increase this a bit. Let's make this about 15 so that it can drop down the noise level in my photo. As you can see, it's spinning here. It's doing its adjustments right now. Cool. Now that that's done, I'm going to go and reduce the chrominance noise a little bit over here. So I'm going to increase this to about 14. If I make this 14, what that will do is just get rid of this color noise as well in the background here. And it's processing the image again. Okay, now over here, the color moire, that's when there's some kind of pattern distortion in the image. I don't think we have that, but I'm going to switch this on anyways, just in case it does occur anywhere in the photo. And that's pretty much all I'm going to do in this setting. Over here, the sharpness, as you can see, carried over from the previous tab. So the sharpness and the one on the previous tab is the same. So now I'm going to go ahead and jump into the tone curves. And over here, as you can see, we've got different kind of tone curves. So we've got the red, green, and blue tone curve, and over here you can see the different color channels. This is a histogram, so on the right hand side is all the highlights. So as you can see, our blue channel or the blue color is a lot on the highlighted side because we've got the sky, we've got the water here, that's all kind of more highlighted than the rest of the photo, and that's why the blue is so high up here. Then you can see we've also got some mid-tones in the green channel and some red channel, and then in the dark shadowy tones on the left hand side we've got some blue, green, and red. So over here what you can do is you can pick an individual channel to adjust, but I'm just going to stick to red, green, and blue and adjust them all at the same time. So what I'm going to try and do is just bring this a little bit more down, and that will bring my darker parts and make them a little bit more darker over here. And the highlights have dropped a little bit, giving it a more darker look. If you move this to the other side, it will become much more brighter. Likewise here, you can adjust your brightness and your contrast. I might just pop the contrast up a little bit. Let's make it at 2. I think 2 was a good number. Let's bring this up all the way till 2. So my contrast is on 2 now. The image is looking like it's nighttime, which is great. I will try and bring out all these lights here to make it look much better. Now watch this video till the end. I'll show you a cool little trick to move this moon in DPP4. There's a little tool we can use to kind of reposition this moon to anywhere we want to. Okay, the next tab I'm going to jump into is to adjust the image colors. Over here, I can customize each individual color channel in this photo. So over here, this is the overall saturation. So I might pump that up a little bit more. Let's make that, let's say 110. So you can also type it in if that's going to pump our colors up a little bit more. Now here, I'm going to go ahead and adjust each channel. So my reds or this building, for example, this is red. What do I want to do with that? I might increase the saturation of the red by just a little bit. And what I'll do as well, I might make it a little bit darker as well. So here's the luminance level, so you can make your reds brighter or darker. Here's the hue, so you can change the whole tone of the reds. And here's the saturation to make it more kind of punchy. Might increase that till 2 actually, to make the reds come out a little bit more. There we go. Now the next one I'm going to do is orange. So a good way to tell whether this photo has any orange is to bring the saturation up all the way, and as you can see there are a lot of orange kind of lights in this photo. So what I'm going to do is bring the orange up not till 10, but I'll do it till about 3. So I'll increase the saturation of the orange maybe till about 4 even, to bring these lights kind of out, make them pop out more, to make the photo more warmer. And then I will adjust the hue of this, so I'm going to change the hue till about -6. And what that will do is that will make the orange color seem a little bit more red. So I'm giving it this kind of red orangey color in this blue photo. So we've got this kind of blue background with this main subject over here, making it kind of warm and inviting and red. Now our yellow color is next. I'm just going to maybe bring up the saturation of the yellow as well, so that all the lights here in this photo come out a little bit brighter. And then I might just increase the luminosity to make them a little bit more brighter as well. And then our green, I don't really see much green except for these windows maybe. I don't really want the green in the photo, so what I'll do is I'll just remove the green altogether. I'm going to take it down all the way to -10. And if I scroll down here, aqua color, do we have any aqua in the photo? Yeah, we do. Some of the sky, some of the water. You can see once I increase it to 10, it actually comes out. So What I'll do is I'll actually drop this a little bit because I don't want to introduce any more blue into this photo. So I'll just drop the aqua one and I might make it a little bit darker as well. There we go. That made it slightly darker. Our blue, which I'm betting is a lot of, I don't really want to change too much. I might just bring the saturation up by one, makes it look more like a night scene. And then my purple, I don't think we have any purple in this photo, or not too much of it anyways, but I don't want any purple. I'm going to decrease that all the way to zero. And my magenta, I'm going to do the same and drop that to minus 10 and minus 10, rather not zero. All right, and that's my colors, and they're looking quite cool now. I'm liking what I'm seeing so far. And we can do a before and after by clicking this little button here so we can see what our progress is. So as you can see, this was the before and this is the after. There's quite a big change. You can see the red is really sticking out. It's looking like a proper night scene now, not just a kind of, you know, in the evening, just coming, starting the evening scene. It's too bright and dull, and this one's sharp and punchy, and it's got a clear image that I wanted to show. So now I'm going to jump back into my single view, and now what I'd like to do next is, we don't need the settings tab here, let's go over to this adjust specific areas tab and let the photo load. All right, now that it's loaded, what I want to do, I want to try and get some detail back into this moon. So either make it a bit more darker and a bit more red maybe, or orangey, not like this just bright ball. I want to restore some color into this. So what I'm going to do is select an adjustment area, and over here it gives me the radius and the size of the brush. So as you can see, by moving the size I can change this. So I'm going to try and match it to the moon, which was pretty much on around 85, maybe 88, something like this. I'm going to zoom in on this photo a little bit now, so let's make it zoom in at 200, and I'm going to locate the moon again, and the moon was somewhere up here. There we go, the moon is here. So now if I go like this, what I'm going to do is bring the brightness down all the way so that when I select the area, I can actually see what I've selected. So I'm going to do is click once here, and that selected my moon. Do I need to kind of choose a bit more on this side, maybe a little bit more on this side? There we go, that covers our whole moon. So now we know we've actually selected the moon. So what I can do now, I'm going to pop the brightness back up to zero, whatever we had it on, so, or minus one. This was the initial brightness. Now to me, let's zoom out a little bit again, or fit to page again. To me that looks all right, but I'm going to try and go for a bit of a darker mood with the moon. So I'm going to decrease the brightness, let's say to minus 9 over here. Now my contrast, if I pump the contrast all the way to 100, you'll see it becomes like one kind of bright ball. If I decrease this to minus 100, you can actually see we got some details back on the moon. So let's just zoom out a little bit and zoom in this way. So there we go. As you can see now, we can actually see the craters on the moon. There is some detail restored. Now the hue, I'm going to drop the hue to minus 30. Let's try change the color a bit. There we go, looking a bit more red now. And the saturation, I might just increase this a bit to make the moon a little bit more saturated. There we go, it looks more orange, like a kind of a blood moon kind of look to it. So now I can go back and fit the image, and as you can see now, our moon's got some detail back and it's looking a little bit darker, a little bit more red and orange. Cool, I'm very happy with that. And what I'm going to do now is crop our image. So I'm going to go into the crop and rotate tab, and I'm going to try crop the image to look the best that it can right now. So once it loads up, let me click on the image once, and now I can choose where I want to actually crop this. So I might bring this down a little bit, do something like that. Let's leave the water in there, don't really want that bird flying there in the top corner, so I'm going to cut that out. Let's do something like this actually. There we go, I'm happy with that. And if you wanted to, you can rotate your image. So I might just change this angle to a little bit, let's see where it was straight. That looks about right. I'm looking at the lines adjusting to the roof of this house here, because I want this house to look straight over here. That looks okay to me. So what I can do now is click away, and that will show me my image how it looks when it's cropped. So I'm quite happy with that so far. Now, one more thing I wanted to do before we try to move the moon, I'm going to go into this perform lens correction data window and make sure my lens data is set to yes. If your lens data is no, go ahead and click on this lens data button, and what it will do, it will actually connect to the internet and download the data of the lens that you've used. I've used the EF-S 18-135mm lens, which it's already downloaded for me, and as you can see here, it does the lens correction for me automatically. You've got other options here which you can adjust. You've got like things like diffraction correction, chromatic aberration here, which you can access by switching on the lens optimizer, but then you're not going to have the lens optimizer set to on. So you could switch these on, or you can just leave the digital lens optimizer on and kind of fiddle with this to the right amount that you want optimized. And you can have a look once it loads up, which one looks the best. For me, this looks all right at the moment. So I'm just going to go back into my main window so I can see the image, how it looks before and after. So if I press this arrange horizontally, let's compare the before and after. And I'm quite happy. This image is looking very nice in my opinion. All right, now let's get to the part where we actually move the moon. Say the moon is a little bit too high, and let's say we wanted the moon somewhere a little bit lower, like in the middle of this building here. So to do that, the first thing we need to do is be in this remove dust or apply a stamp tool. So let's click on that and let's wait for our photo to load up. Now that it's loaded up, you can see all these options are available. What we're going to do is we're going to click on select copy source, and then over here you've got two options. You've got pencil and brush. What this select copy source does is lets you click anywhere on the screen. So for example, I can click on this tower. If I have brush selected, it lets me brush a copy of what I've selected over here. If I select the pencil one, it does the same, but it's much more harder. It doesn't have these soft edges around. It just puts in exactly what's there, and you can see a big difference around. So to undo all that, I'm just going to click this undo button, and I'm going to select copy source and try to click in the very center of the moon. So if I get my arrow aligned somewhere here and I click in the middle, and now what I can do is it gives me the brush size. So I want to get the brush to the exact same size the moon is. So that's a bit small still. So if I make this about, let's say 95 perhaps. Yeah, that seems like that's the right size. So now we've selected where we're copying from, which is the moon. We've got it set on pencil, which is that hard setting. And we've got our radius set to 95. What I can then do is think about where I want to position the moon. Let's say we wanted to put it right somewhere here, just above the tower. And I can click once, and that moves the moon right where we wanted it. And now to get rid of the second moon, what I'm going to do is select copy source again, change this to brush type, and I'm going to select the source right next to this previous moon, and I'm going to start just kind of covering it up by just holding the left mouse button and dragging to the left. There we go, we've covered the moon up, and we've moved the moon successfully from the top here to right in the middle of the tower, where it looks kind of cool. It looks like we had to wait with this photo to get it into the right position, but in reality we can just use DPP4 to move the moon to where we want it. And this is a really useful tool. I do have a video on how to use this tool properly if you want to remove people from your photo or remove unwanted images. I will put a link to that in the description also. And there we have it. Let's have a look at the before and after, and let's see if we're happy with our photo. There we go. In my opinion, the photo on the right looks a lot better. It makes it look like it's nighttime, and it's got this warm, inviting kind of color right in the center here where the restaurants are and the bars, and where this house over here is, or the boathouse over here is. And to the left, this photo was a little bit kind of washed out, not very interesting, whereas this one has some cool tones to it. And that's what I've got for today. And this was just a practical example on how to use Canon's DPP4, kind of like a reminder video of all the past tutorials that we've done. So I hope you enjoyed this video. And that's what I've got for today. Thank you so much for watching this tutorial, this kind of practical example. I hope you learned something. I hope it helps you out. I hope it helped you remember what we've learned in the past so you can go edit your photos using DPP4. If you did like this video, as always, do give me a thumbs up and do consider subscribing to this channel. I'll be doing a lot more videos to come in the future. So thanks for watching. Stay safe, take care, and goodbye.